Oh, Sean, Sean, Sean. Yeah. You've been so naughty. The promises you made, Sean. The promises.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, and Chris are joined by Will Parsons and Sarah Christina Wells for a holiday party full of side conversations, including impressions of Final Fantasy XV and Super Mario Run. Plus, a new game show, Naughty or Nice. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 87 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, games and new media with a splash of academia. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, guys.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And we have two very good friends joining us for our holiday special this year. We have Will Parsons.
Hey, everybody.
And Sarah Christina Wells.
Hi.
And this week we're going to be having something of a holiday party. We have our friends over, and we're going to be having lots of conversations on various topics, including some nice holiday-themed things. We're going to be doing our annual gift-giving edition of Wishlist, and we've got a new game show we're going to try out called Naughty or Nice. But first, we're going to open up with the Button Mosh.
Get ready for the Button Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
So I've been playing Final Fantasy XV, which, if some of you have been following the very, very, very long development cycle for this game, you might remember it originally being announced as Final Fantasy Versus XIII. It was supposed to be part of kind of a trio of games. There was going to be the mainline Final Fantasy XIII, and then there was Versus XIII, and then there was also, I think it was like Agito XIII. And that one eventually became Type Zero, and Versus eventually became Final Fantasy XV because they took forever to make it.
They finally gave up. They're like, all right, guys, everyone hates Final Fantasy XIII. Let's just move on.
This is the one with the like the Neo Greasers and the cars, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Just making sure.
I never thought of them as the Greasers, but yeah, that's not a terrible point.
Slicked back hair or slicked out hair, leathers, and
very spiky.
Yeah fancy cars. It's totally Greasers.
Yeah. It's funny because like they sort of wear these like very stylish, almost punky outfits, and yet they're it's their uniforms apparently. Like they're part of some military unit, and they get to anyway.
This is.
Yeah, I've seen some of the outfits on that. It looks kind of weird, too. Like, I know, like, one of the guys, he just wears a vest. Like, no shirt underneath, just a vest.
Yeah, he wears a vest.
Like, okay. Whatever, man. Whatever works for
like
you.
Like Aladdin, right?
Yeah, I guess so, but he's not really in the desert. Like,
it's kind of a throwback to the 90s.
Actually,
it's retro fashion.
Retro fashion.
I want to say it's a jacket, actually. It's just a jacket with no shirt underneath.
Jacket? Okay.
Yeah. But anyway, The setup premise is that you are playing as a prince named Noctis, and you are being sent off to go basically be married to someone for a political alliance sort of thing. But they kind of glaze over a lot of the story. I have a feeling that you're supposed to either know about going into it or have watched the movie Kingsglaive, and maybe like there, I think there's an anime special or something like that they did to sort of set up some of the before stuff. But they give you a very basic sort of, you're starting off on your journey, they waste no time with it. And you set out in a car, and basically you're free for the most part to explore this very large region, and actually the landscape is massive and it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a really good looking game.
And it's basically you're in a convertible, right? And you're just road trip. You just have a road trip with your buddies. Is that kind of
more or less? Yeah, like
so
you.
So it's a bachelor party road trip. Final Fantasy RPG.
More or less, yeah.
And I prefer to call it Urban Fantasy Bachelor Party.
There you go.
There it is.
No.
Oh, that explains the jacket with no shirt underneath.
Oh!
Now I get
he
it.
He lost his shirt playing poker.
Yeah, there we go.
The kind of poker that his fiance would not approve of.
But you basically drive to the port where you're supposed to take a ship across the sea to go do this, but the port is closed. Your kingdom is actually at war with this empire. And so that's something that kind of comes up as you leave. You kind of find out a few days later that your father's been killed in this war. And so there's a little bit of, like, there's this urgent quest that you're on. You're trying to take care of the stuff so you can get overseas and do these big things. And yet you're kind of having this sort of leisurely road trip. You know, you can kind of take your time. There is a sense of urgency in theory, but the game doesn't really reinforce a sense of urgency most of the time.
The bad guys are going to sit up at the top of the stairs playing poker until you're done running all your side quests.
Yeah, yeah.
Someone said that one point.
But that being said, I'm actually really enjoying my time with it. There's this really great sense of rhythm, because what you do is the game is divided into days, and you can do things at nighttime, but they discourage it because they're very powerful enemies come out at nighttime. And so you can do quests and you can get experience that way. And you have to stop for the night to gather or to tell your experience. So if you get a game over before you get a chance to sort of rest up, then you lose all that progress unless you happen to save somewhere midday. So it really gives you this great sense of you've got, like, you know, you set out to do something for the day, and when it starts getting into evening, you either find a hotel or a motel or something like that, or you set up camp, and they have specific, you know, campsites you can set up at.
Oh, are there rest stops?
Yeah, they're rest stops.
Okay.
You
gotta be careful with the rest stops too, right?
How do you mean?
Vagrants hang out there?
No, not really. No.
There's no vagrants in Final Fantasy. Everyone has a job in the world of Final Fantasy.
Basically, yeah.
Everyone has a home.
So it's fantasy cruising USA with random encounters.
Yeah. Not so much random encounters. Like, you go off the road, you go into the wilderness, you can actually see and avoid enemies if you want to. And even if you get into an engagement, you can just run away from the engagement.
Did you mean drive away?
No, it's running. And I think actually at nighttime, like, things will pop up, and sometimes the Empire will, like, have a drop ship that gets in the way and you have to get out of your car and fight them off before you can proceed, that sort of thing. But for the most part, they don't sort of force that stuff on you very often.
Can you use your car in combat?
Not that I'm aware of. I've not tried it.
Like, now, a summon?
No.
Now, what if I would rather drive a chocobo, because that is one of my favorite things in Final Fantasy.
And actually, that was one of the...
Who cares about cars?
That was one of my favorite moments in the game, actually, is when I first got a chocobo, because you're basically, you know, getting very used to just running from place to place.
Uh-huh.
When you get a chocobo, not only are you just constricted to the roads, but now you can go freely at a pretty good pace, and it feels really good to ride them. Actually, the first day I got them in-game, I actually rode across, like, half the continent to get to my next destination, rather than taking the car there. So that's kind of awesome.
What's the gameplay like? Like, the actual combat, I should say.
It's an action RPG. So it actually takes a little bit of getting used to, and you have to really be paying attention. In brief, you have to alternate between... You can switch different weapons that have different effects against different enemies. And you hold down the circle button. I'm playing on PS4 to just do, like, an automatic chain attack. And then you hold down square to get ready to dodge or to do a counter or something like that. So you have to really be watching the enemy. And it's more about sort of keeping an eye on the flow of the battle more so than it is about, like, hitting, like, combos and that sort of thing.
So when you say an action RPG, you're talking more like Chrono Trigger rather than, like, Star Ocean.
I've not played either, so I can't really tell you.
What? Okay. Stop. Turn it off.
In Chrono Trigger and others, it's still turn-based, but it's active, so you're still setting up for doing different things. Whereas in Star Ocean, it's completely active. You're switching between three or four party members, but they're all constantly moving. There are no turns whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. It's more like that.
If you play Tales of?
Yes.
It's similar to Star Ocean in that regard.
Same developers initially.
You play only as one character, but you can give some orders here and there to your other party members, and you can equip them and stuff like that.
But this one, I think, it seems more like kind of similar to Final Fantasy XII. In terms of the combat, or something like maybe an MMO's version of action. Like, you're not really swinging your sword and dodging and stuff like that.
Not attack per attack.
It's not really.
It's kind of hard to describe.
It's like an MMO. It's like an MMO, right?
It doesn't feel like an MMO at all to me. You know, kind of to comment on the road trip thing real quick as I start to wrap this up. One of the things that's really cool about it, and, like, they kind of reinforce the road trip idea with one of the characters in your group is a photographer, and he's snapping photos of either, like, you know, scenic locations you stop by, or even in the middle of battle sometimes. And at the end of the day, you actually get to look at all the different photos he's taken. You can save some of them to albums. And so I had this kind of funny moment where I was showing my brother a few, and I was kind of reflecting back on, like, oh yeah, this is from when I had that, you know, day-long chocobo trip across the continent and stuff like that. He's like, are you having, like, actual memories and nostalgia over this fake road trip you've been taking? I'm like, yeah, I kind of am. And that's one of, like, the really, like, just fun things about this game. It's really enjoyable. I'm having really a lot of fun with it. Doc, I think actually you might like it too, because it has really great elements of exploration.
Yeah.
I think you'd probably like this kind of road trippy rhythm. I know. It's a really, I'd actually really recommend this one. They actually say in the startup screen, a Final Fantasy for fans and first-timers or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're trying to appeal to both audiences. I think it's a very modern take on Final Fantasy that's doing a lot of stuff that has been kind of proven to be good design in open-world games, while also having a lot of the elements that longtime fans of Final Fantasy appreciate.
Cool.
Let's all go on a nostalgia trip to see what we can learn from games of the past.
Got a game that I've been playing recently. It's a game that was translated a couple of years ago. I just haven't had a chance to play it. Called The Frog for Whom the Bell Tolls.
What was it translated from?
Japanese.
Oh, okay.
And it's an original...
Two countries that make games. That's it.
Well, that's a good point.
No, no,
I was joking. I was being facetious. I fully realized, because Tetris.
Poland and...
Oh. Witcher.
Yeah.
But yeah, so this is actually a very interesting game.
Was it For Whom the Bell Tolls a poem?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It was actually a song, for Metallica song.
Oh, okay. So which one's it based on?
The Metallica song, of course.
Okay.
Where's the frog come in?
Yeah, so essentially this is actually a kind of a comedic adventure RPG, might call it. So, yeah, the thing about the game, way I can describe it, so it's an original Game Boy game actually developed by Nintendo, or more specifically Intelligent Systems.
Mm, okay.
One of the main designers for this game is actually Yoshio Sakamoto, who y'all might remember as one of the co-creators of Metroid.
You're kidding.
So it has a pretty solid pedigree behind it. It just never ended up getting translated and sent over to America. However, the game uses the same engine that was used for Link's Awakening on the Game Boy, which is, of course, a very well-known Zelda title.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, and you can tell right away, the graphics are very similar to that game. The main difference is, one, this is a lot more, the way they present the story is a lot more comedic. So the idea is that there's these two princes, you're one of these princes for these kingdoms, who have this competition, a friendly competition, and Princess Taramasu gets kidnapped, and so you go off to, like, save her, but you're not really, you're sort of trying to save her, but really you're trying to beat your friend before, like, you got to save her before he gets to her. Because you have to look like the cool guy as opposed to him. And so they do a whole bunch of jokes. Like, you start out the game with max money, like 999999 money, and then you just start flagrantly flaunting your money and giving it away for just the most ridiculous things. Like, someone comes out and gives you, you know, like a potion, and you're like, here you go, here's a million coins. So by the time you finally get control, you're just broke. It's just on purpose, just to kind of make a joke, or like you are. So
it's kind of a fun way of explaining away the fact that, like, you're royalty and yet you're broke. You know, at the beginning of the game, because you always start the game with little or no money,
right? So. And you don't understand the concept of money.
Austin.
Right. You don't understand the concept of money either. The other part about this game, so even though it's based on the same engine as Legend of Zelda: Link's Awakening, it's not really an action game at all. There's no action elements to it. Instead, there are enemies, but the way it works is you have stats. You have, like, life and power, speed. But when you attack, there's this, like, poof of smoke, and it goes... They just do, like, a quick turn-based back and forth with your, you know, number of hearts and hits. You don't control any of it. It's just solely based on the numbers.
So the poof of smoke is kind of like the old cartoony...
The old cartoony, yeah. Like They, arms and swords coming out of the side.
Out and exactly. Then one emerges the winner,
Right. So you kind of know, as when you go into it, who's going to win.
Mm.
The whole point is you have to find all the items in that area, solving puzzles to do so, like classic Zelda style. There's various puzzles to solve in the environment. Solving puzzles to do so in order to get your stats high enough so you can win.
Mm-hmm. Actually, that kind of makes sense for Intelligent Systems, too, because they also did Fire Emblem.
Yes.
So you can kind of go into Fire Emblem not knowing who's going to win, but it's fairly predictable based on who has more health, who's going to get more hits in, that sort of thing.
And where the frog comes in, to what Doc was talking about earlier, is you actually get turned into a frog when you go visit a witch, and you decide that she's very trustworthy when she gives you a potion. Oh, you already ate a poisoned apple that she tricks you into eating. But then when she gives you the potion, she says, oh, I'm sorry about the poisoned apple. Here's this potion. Go ahead and drink it. You're like, okay, cool, no problem.
They took the fairy tale deck and just shuffled it, basically.
Yeah, you're actually very gullible as a character. So you do become a frog, which has benefits and negatives. You actually can swim, but you can't attack anymore. So I'm at the point now where I think I'm about to transform back. So it's probably like a back and forth transformation type thing. But it does allow you to swim. You can't swim until you transform into a frog.
That actually reminds me of Link's Awakening too. The transformation element.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
There's a lot of elements that are similar. The way they do the incorporate story is very similar. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the way dialogue is presented, sort of the over-the-top yelling and stuff like that, a lot of like the story takes place in towns that you travel between, which you do in Link's Awakening. You go back to one town, but in this one you travel to multiple towns. But just, it's an interesting game. I recommend checking it out if you can. It just, you will basically have to find the translated
version. What's it on?
Game Boy, the original Game Boy.
All right. Is there going to be a sequel? Highly misogynistic version for Whom the Bell Tolls, Other Frog?
No. I will say, though, that they did have, y'all might recognize the main character, who is just called the Sable Prince, because that's the kingdom that he's from. He was an assist trophy in the new Smash Brothers for Wii U.
Oh, okay.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
So I stumbled upon a really weird thing this week that I felt like I had to talk about. And I don't know, it's not so much of an overall review as it is just a complaint about something I spent maybe 15 seconds on. And that's Facebook Messenger, the app, has games embedded in it. I don't know if you've seen this, but they're there. So they're... at least, I don't know, at least on mine, there's like three that you can play. And one of them is Pac-Man, like the original actual Pac-Man.
So is the idea here that, like, because it's Messenger, that you're kind of going back and forth with someone, like taking turns playing the game?
Yeah, I guess so.
It's versus Pac-Man.
Yeah, but, well, no, it's not. I mean, it's more like
asynchronous, beat my high score Pac-Man.
Yeah, yeah. And honestly, I'm kind of assuming things because I just didn't get that deep into it. I literally tried playing one time and went, oh, touchscreen. And that's what happened. And there's another one. It's called like Infinite Lake or something like that. And you basically, it's just a runner and you're trying to just jump. And the controls were so bad that I couldn't get past the first couple of jumps and I just gave up. I just quit. Mm-hmm. And so there was no learning curve of, hey, this is how you play this game and look, we're teaching and we're getting you addicted to it and it's interesting and all that. No, just out of the gate completely. So, and then the last one was Galaga. And the, you know, the greatest thing about Galaga is that you've got the stick, right, and you're moving, and then you've got another, you're on your other hand, you're hitting the buttons.
Right.
You know, and so you've got the stick, and you're like, buttons, boom, 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 boom. It's a touch screen. You cannot move and fire. You can move or fire.
Huh.
So I actually really enjoyed this one game. I actually beat it, Radiant Free.
Uh-huh.
It solves those problems. It's not Galaga, but it's that upward scrolling, shoot the aliens. Your gun just doesn't stop firing. Mm. You can just move.
See, that makes so much more sense.
Yeah, it works really well, and it's actually a really fun flavor.
Well, this is something that Jim and I were talking about on the way here. And it's the idea of porting games over into a touchscreen space is just a bad idea. It's just a terrible idea. But building games for a touchscreen space, that's a whole different nut to crack.
Yeah, the one I was talking about was, I'm probably going to get the name wrong, Kirby Canvas Curse. Where it's not like a normal platformer Kirby where you run and jump and absorb enemies. You're just a little ball and you draw his track for him using the touchscreen. So if you do something like that where it's designed for a touchscreen, I think it works. But something like Pac-Man or Galaga, which are designed for, you know, an arcade stick or, you know, a D-pad or something, and then buttons, it doesn't really work to port that over to a touchscreen.
Prefacing it by saying that I actually don't like playing games on mobile because of this issue, that sounds more like the programmers got lazy. And I say that mostly because of Christian Whitehead, which means that I have to reference a Sonic game. I'm sorry, it's going to happen.
Well, we wouldn't invite Sean if you weren't going to.
Sonic 1 and 2, Christian Whitehead released them. They work perfectly on a mobile platform.
But do they really?
So I actually got all the way through Sonic 1 just playing on the basic controls. It wasn't all that fun. I would much rather set it up and have the, what is it?
An actual controller?
Yes, which you can do. But it's got all phones have the multi-touch at this point.
No, I believe that you can do it, but I think even in that sense, there's some negatives there. One would be obviously the difference between just putting buttons for like up, down, left, right versus actually a D-pad that you can roll your thumb over. Mm-hmm. And then two,
the haptic feedback
is the other. The haptic feedback I think is really important.
You can like accidentally move your
buttons
thumb too
being
far
pushed off. And with D-pad movement, it's extremely important as well to know, you know, diagonals and all that.
I would agree mostly on that, with the exception of the fact that when I first switched over from like the T9 button press, etc., to a digital keyboard, I had the exact same response, and then I just adapted to it. My number one issue with all mobile games that have an interface on the screen, it covers up the screen and I can't see what's going on.
Yeah, that is another problem.
That is the only complaint I have about Christian Whitehead's porting of the Sonic games, is the fact that I'm covering up part of the screen. It's usually below the line you're running on, but not always.
Right.
And if I can't see what's coming, it's a problem.
And to use a game, this is actually not a... this is not even a mobile game, but it is a game that uses a touchscreen. Mario Maker makes very good use of the touchscreen in terms of, you know, the level building and all of that. So it's not so much that I'm against touchscreen games. I'm just against a lot of the flaws that they sort of, you know, the traps they fall into, I guess. Oh. Plus, they really should be designing it from the start as a game that's going to be on a touchscreen.
Yeah, and that's a great segue into Super Mario Run, which just came out recently. This is a Nintendo-made iPhone release.
That's a Nintendo-made Sonic game, you said?
No.
No. Actually, and it's funny because I've told a few people about it, and the thing that first pops into their head because the title Run and
Infinite Runner.
They're thinking Infinite Runner.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
That's what I thought
too. Not an Infinite Runner. It's actually a Mario game that they pitch as being playable with one hand. And what, you know, speaking to your point, Will, about the interface, you know, your thumb covering the interface, they specifically designed the screen so there's a very large portion at the bottom of the screen that's just clear for you to touch without, you know, obstructing anything. Basically, Mario runs to the right automatically. You tap to jump. You can, you know, tap and hold to jump higher. You can tap in midair to do little spins. There's a lot of contextual stuff, but everything is done with just, you know, one finger. And it is stage-based. So I actually really like it myself because the way I always used to play Mario games, I didn't do a lot of backtracking and having move left and right, that sort of thing. I always used to just, like, you know, run forward and jump and dodge stuff. I basically played Mario like I played Sonic because I played Sonic first. And it's really well designed. The level designers really, I think, had a good grasp of what the implications of this design choice were, that you're always moving right and you can only jump. And there's sometimes ways to go backward by, like, there are these backward-facing blocks. If you jump on those, you'll jump backward, or you can wall jump to go backward, that sort of thing. There's really an emphasis. There's not a ton of levels. They basically let you play three levels for free, and then the fourth level, it's the final level of that world. You can play, I think, like 20 seconds or something like that for free. And then anything beyond that, you have to pay to buy the app.
Is it you buy the app once, or is it you buy per level?
You buy the app once. So you pay $10 and you get the entire game. There's only 24 worlds in total, 6 worlds with 4 levels each, which to me seemed a little bit small, but then I realized that it has a lot more replay appeal, at least for me, than most full-length Mario games do. Because they really put an emphasis on kind of like... more style than speed. So, like, I would say speed running, but it's more that you're trying to sort of get really good runs of, like, collecting all of a special type of coin. And then once you clear that, then you can replay the level again, trying to get another set of coins that are now in different places, and sometimes you can reconfigure the level a little bit.
Are there any power-ups in this game?
Yes, there are. So you can get mushrooms, you can get invincibility stars.
What about Fire Flower?
Not Fire Flowers, no. But you can play as different characters. Eventually you can unlock by syncing your Nintendo ID account. You can get Toad basically for free. And he is interesting because he runs a little bit faster than Mario, has about the same jump, but he doesn't, when he collects mushrooms, he just gets bonus coins. And this is actually the case for everyone but Mario. So
that
basically
reminds me of 2. Like Mario 2, Mario Brothers 2.
Mm. Yeah,
Super Mario Brothers 2, that's
right. Except in Mario 2, Toad was the one that was stronger.
Well, yeah, but the point is that the different characters had different abilities.
Mm-hmm. They do that in Super Mario 3D World, I think it's called, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, Super Mario 3D World for the Wii U, where they have they sort of reinvigorate that concept with
Mario,
Luigi, Toad, and Peach. It's actually really good.
Okay.
And so kind of the trade-off is that when you get a mushroom with anyone but Mario, you get coins instead. And that's kind of, that becomes important in a mode called Toad Rally, where basically you face off asynchronously with someone who's run the course, and they're collecting coins just like you are. And you're trying to collect more coins and have fewer deaths because you lose coins upon getting beat. And if you pull off more stunts and more kind of fancy stuff, these toads will cheer for you. So between having the toads cheering for you, hopefully more for you than for the other person,
and getting more coins than them, you can collect a bunch of toads, which are then used to buy buildings and stuff like that for your kingdom builder, which I'm not going to get into much right now. Suffice to say that that is a way that you can get more toad rally tickets, so you can keep that going. I don't believe there are in-app purchases for that. And to unlock other characters. So far I've unlocked Yoshi that way, who does like the kind of like, you know, kicking, floating jump that he does, like a little bit of an extra U at the top of his jump arc. And once you've cleared all the levels at least once, you unlock Peach, who has her signature float that she does. I find it to be a really well-designed, you know, kind of taking Mario and applying it to the mobile space in a really smart way. I would definitely say if you have an iPhone, check out the free level, see if it appeals to you. And if you hit that paywall and you're wondering whether or not you should go with it, or go for it, I would say absolutely. I think it's a really good game.
Latest entry in the thinly veiled drug culture metaphor that is Mario.
It's not an advertisement for Italian food?
No, it's a warrant.
Yeah, Luigi was actually supposed to be Linguini, but they misspelled it.
I guess this Saturday morning, the Super Mario Brothers Super Show misled me.
they didn't have the whole pasta power motif constantly yelling that out, eating so giant plates of pasta.
Yep.
Carbohydrates.
That's why he could jump so high, apparently. Does Peach use, before we move on, is it Peach just has magical float, or does she have the parasol?
No, I think it's implicitly her dress. The dress is catching air, and that's why she's able to float. So it's not floating straight across, it's kind of just like a slow descent.
She's the Batman of Mario.
Do they call her Peach, or do they call her Princess Toadstool in this one?
Princess Peach.
Okay, yeah, they've called her Peach pretty much consistently since they changed the name.
I was pretty sure that was
Mario
the case.
3.
But I don't follow Mario games closely enough, so I always...
You should. They're much better than Sonic.
You know, that is an argument.
Well, in
which
recent,
I think we'll have to save for another
it's
time.
Pretty hard
I'm just leaving
it's
it at that. I'm
that
just up. Leaving it at that's an argument.
This is Wishlist, our most anticipated games that are either unreleased or we haven't had a chance to play.
All right, so you might recall that this time last year we introduced a new segment called Wishlist, and we are continuing the tradition this year by saying that this wishlist is about games that we would get for people as gifts. And so we've come up with a few categories this time. We're going to sort of talk about what we think of this. Our first category is, you've got friends together for the holidays, you got family together for the holidays. What's a good party game you can give some? These can be board games or video games, but a good party game to play with a wide range of people types.
I'd say right off the bat for me, if you have a Wii U, Mario Kart 8, I think everyone can pretty much pick up and play it. It's not a sort of game that you're going to get confused. You can sit like Grandma June down and hand her a controller, and she can probably still at least go. She's probably not going to win, but she can probably play it.
You know, I love Mario Kart, but I have one very specific problem with it. And it's if you're good at Mario Kart, you're going to win. And if you're new to Mario Kart, you're going to lose.
How is that a problem?
Well, it's a problem because when you go over to the party setting and you have the, the regionals, whoever owns the game is just basically going to win.
Right, but it's a game. If you're good, you're going to win. Otherwise, what's the point of playing?
Well, I think it has more to do with ways to balance it out. Having different characters, that kind of a thing.
They do have a lot of those in there, though, because, I mean, there's a lot of randomness, right?
Like when you're talking about the PvP experience, I'm a strong believer in what you're saying. The problem is I don't like to play those games because I don't own them.
I think you just don't like losing. That's what it sounds like.
That's correct.
Well, see, and that's the problem. Like, if you have someone, if you're talking like a wide variety of people, like that will include some people who aren't gamers. And do you want to turn them on to the idea of gaming, or make them just like
feel
like why are you just? This is just for you to show off and play more of your stupid.
Let's
games.
School grandma.
This kind of seriously.
Who never got off the starting grid.
The wonders how the internet works.
Insurmountable kind of like I can't get into this because I'm never gonna be this good. Sort of feeling. Yeah,
whereas exactly. Something like bowling. You remember Wii Bowling? Man, that was the truly quintessential approachable game for all types. I remember my great grandmother-in-law, she would take that little Wii stick and she'd be like, I'm
a ball, and she'd do it, man. She would trash us all. It was great.
Because
all she had to do was sit in her wheelchair and just flick her wrist.
I hated that game.
I saw your expression over there, and I was like, Will hates it.
It's not even just that I wasn't good at it. Mm-hmm. I was terrible at it. It was more the fact that I got it, like, I got it the night the thing was released.
Uh-huh.
And I got Twilight Princess.
Yeah.
I didn't get to touch Twilight Princess for a week. Because I come from a family of six people.
Right.
With extendeds. And they would just play bowling all the time.
All bowling all the time.
It gets boring. Like, I played a little bit. It gets boring after the first 5 minutes for me.
Yeah. So. Oh, well, there you go. But, did you ever play it after they upgraded the controller with the I don't even know what they called it.
Oh, the Motion Plus.
The Motion Plus, yeah. Did you ever play it after that?
No, I was not.
It got significantly better.
So as a concept, and this is a very generalistic thing, I don't like playing games of things I can do in real life. I'm terrible at bowling in real life.
I'm with you on that.
The one time I broke 100, they canceled our game in the last 3 frames, so I never finished it. It's the closest I've ever gotten to winning at bowling. But if I can do it in real life, I don't like playing it in games. It's why I don't play sports games. I have no issue with them. I just don't like playing... I don't play a baseball video game because I go out and play baseball with my brothers and my dad.
I'm a much better virtual bowler than I am an actual bowler, so I guess maybe that's part of it.
Oh, I am too. I just don't want to do something I can do in real life.
Although I have to admit, after playing literally hundreds of hours of bowling back in the day, we went to a bowling alley and I bowled the best game I ever bowled after taking bowling in college. So there's something to be said for the neuroplasticity of going through the motions.
Yeah. There's actually also something when you're choosing games to play with a group that includes complete noobs, the attitude you bring can be more important than the game.
That's so very true.
Because if you go in there like Super Smash Brothers, I hate that game. Mm-hmm. I hate it a lot.
Me too.
Because most of the times that I've played, it has just been everybody going full throttle. I like Pokemon. I like Jigglypuff. Mm-hmm. Apparently that makes me a terrible person and let's just go after her. Mm. No one has ever explained why. It's my favorite Pokemon and I like it as well, one of my favorite Pokemon. So, and you know, like one time one person actually sat down and explained something to me and then we played for 10 minutes and then I went away and forgot it. But mm-hmm. It's like... basically, everyone's, like, already at that expert level, and then they don't want to bother explaining. They just want to go at each other, and you're there, so they're going to go after you, too. So if you want to bring something like Mario Kart, don't have the mindset of, I'm here to win. Have the mindset of, I'm here to help them learn to enjoy it. Don't go after that best bonus just because you can. Leave it for grandma or your little cousin or whoever.
That is a fair tip. Yeah. It's not one that will be followed in my place, but fair tip.
It does depend on your crowd, too. Yeah.
There is a very specific way to fix all of these games, and it's designed into every Nintendo Party game to be played that way. When I play Smash Brothers, I have one very specific set of rules that I use for playing it. Because I'm tired of the way people play it when they argue for skill.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone has to be a random character. Mm-hmm. No exceptions. All levels are on... at random, no exceptions, all items are on.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, it does not matter how good you think you are. Everyone is on a level playing field.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Get the character you are best at, because most people are not used to playing with items on or on stages that are not just flat.
It adds to the randomness, and they do that. There are a lot of stage hazards in some of those stages as well. So there is definitely randomness elements in Smash Bros. The other part of that, too, is that you can go in, I think they do this in the newest one, I'm not sure, but I know in a lot of the old ones you can go in and add handicaps to different people, so you can do that too. So there's ways you can actually balance it out where you can play and go, okay, well, we all know what we're doing, you don't, so we're going to handicap ourselves to make it so that we get knocked out much easier. So there's ways you can do it. I would generally disagree with intentionally trying to lose, because then it's like there's no point in playing.
That's why I like
I'd rather just
thing.
Balance it
it's
out.
It's not so much trying to lose as like, you know, like if you're playing a board game, there's a concept of having a teaching round. You know, have a teaching round instead of just going full at it the whole time right off the bat. When you've got someone who has no idea what they're doing, they're interested in this activity and in spending time, or at least with spending time with you, they're not going to enjoy that activity if the first thing that happens is you just smash them.
Yeah, sure. You give them like a couple of minutes of running through the controls, but then after that,
how new
sink
are
or
they?
Swim.
How new are they?
How did you learn how to swim?
My dad, I got picked up and taught me. See, I got picked up.
I got picked up by my grandfather, thrown into a creek, and it's like, hey. Swim. Sink
this
or swim.
This is explaining a lot about you, Jim.
See, that's what I'm talking about.
My dad,
sink or swim.
Grew up doing that, decided, you know, maybe I don't want to lose my kid.
There were also crocodiles in this creek. There were alligators
in my pond. I don't know what your point is. We were in Florida.
I had to swim up a waterfall.
Nice.
There you go.
Yeah, wow.
Initially, I couldn't swim. We were in a mangrove river swamp. Mm. So huge trees, massive roots. The guy just threw me underneath a waterfall and was like, get out of there.
Yep. There you go.
That was the day I learned to swim.
Well, let's go ahead and move on then to our next category. Younger kids, and you can specify the age you're thinking of, but if you're getting a game for a younger kid to introduce them to gaming, what do you think you would give them?
Candyland?
It was like a board game?
It is yes. How do you not know what Candyland is?
No,
I know.
No, I'm just shocked that you're considering that a game, considering that the victory conditions.
Okay, it would depend on the age of the child.
Uh-huh.
But when I saw that on the board, that's the first thing that came to mind.
I have a 2-year-old, and I would not insult my 2-year-old with Candyland.
I have fond memories of Candyland. But let me explain. How I figured out that the whole random luck chance draw. There's no skill here.
But
I figured it out by doing
it. Okay, there you go.
And that is valuable.
I'll buy that.
Also, I really liked the art on the game board.
Well, that's true.
The copy of the game I had some great art.
Nothing tops Candyland art. I'll give you that one.
The art was good, and I learned.
But the problem that I have with Candyland is that the outcome of the game is predetermined from the moment you start.
Mm-hmm. It is, and that is where I learned how that works. That's where I learned about
one can
that
fix this easily by simply dealing 3 cards to each player.
Pick a color.
Oh.
Every time that color draws, you have to play musical chairs.
Oh, very nice. I think that works too.
I would just say cheat, because that's what I did.
Oh.
I used to play with my younger sisters, and they didn't know any better.
Uh-huh.
So I would just cheat every time.
Okay. Like, we're learning a lot about Jim today.
We are.
Well, see, I like to win. So, in a game that you can't win unless it's just you know, predetermined, you get the right one off the bat, you have to find other ways to pull it off.
I'm more of a Hi-Ho Cheerio man, personally.
I remember that game.
Yeah,
we were missing so many cherries, we couldn't play it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking, though, from this topic, because it was one that I came up with, because I've got a young nephew, he's about 5, starting to get into looking at different video games, and I'm looking at, from a video game perspective, what sort of, because at a certain point, it's a lot easier for a young kid to play around with like a board game necessarily than a video game. There's a little bit more hand-eye coordination they have to have for a video game, even a simplistic video game for the most part. So what do y'all think in terms of an early child's first video games or early video games? True video gaming experiences, not just...
I forget if I mentioned last year that I wanted to get Yoshi's Woolly World for my niece.
Mm-hmm.
And she was, I want to say, 3 at the time.
Oh, that's pretty young.
Yeah, very young. And she actually... She's now starting to get a little bit better at it, but of course it's still a little bit above her level.
Yeah.
She's not quite getting it. Maybe she will soon if she keeps playing it. But I actually found that a game that was really good for her was Lego City Undercover. It's a kid-friendly open-world game, and so basically it just lets them explore, and it lets them just, you know, hop into cars and drive around, and she's terrible at it, and a lot of times she would, you know, ask me to help her get to the top of a building or something like that because she wanted to go see a thing. But it's an open-ended sort of experience that lets them kind of just get the hang of gaming without any sort of pressures of, you know, getting taken out of a level, having to get through a level, anything like that.
That's a great idea.
That is actually a really good idea.
I tend to prefer the... throw them out there and let them pedal back. And so to give some clarity to that, my youngest brother, Super Mario Brothers 1, difficult game?
Pretty difficult, yeah.
3 years old.
Yeah.
Beat it.
Yeah.
3 years old. If a 3-year-old can do that, there's really just start them on any game.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking of the same thing really when I thought of 5 because, you know, I got my NES when I was maybe 4 or something, and I'd played games before that at my grandfather's place when I was like 3. So I was playing these games that, you know, nowadays you would never think of giving a kid a game like Super Mario Bros. 1 or like, you know, the original Legends of Zelda or like Metroid or something like that, because you're like, they're not going to be able to figure this out. Well, that's not really true.
My catch for this would be pay attention to the child. Mm-hmm. If they're a person who gets frustrated by not being able to complete it, don't give them that. If they're someone who just wants to play a game, give them anything.
Yeah.
Give them Ninja Gaiden, the original.
Yeah.
That's a terrible idea. They will never beat it.
Mm-hmm. But the first few levels, though, are actually really not that bad. Yeah. It just gets really nasty later in the game.
Well, you know, I remember, and I'd love to do a whole show on this sometime, but I remember whenever I was, I think, 12, and I got my Nintendo Entertainment System for my birthday. And it was learning. I mean, we literally didn't have the vocabulary to play. The first level of Mario was about learning how to play video games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we had so much fun with that first level of Mario that... you know, my birthday party was a sleepover, and just all of us just took turns. My turn, my turn, my turn, my turn. And we watched, and somebody got to the end of the level, like, yeah! You know? And it was just, you can't, I don't know, it's almost like kids today just have it in their DNA that they can play a video game. And I honestly, I think what it comes down to is we just didn't have it till we were 12 or 15 or 20 or however old. And so it's changed the way we think about it.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's a topic for another day. Put a pin in that one.
Well, yeah, I was going to ask, what makes you think you're going to get, unless it's your child, what makes you think you're going to give them their first game experience?
Oh, there you go.
His 2-year-old asks for the iPad.
It's true, he does.
And I've seen him play with things that I would define as an interactive application.
Absolutely.
Also, things that I would define as a game. I do differentiate between those things. Mm-hmm. But there are some things in there that he does that it's like, yeah, that's basically a game.
Yeah.
Okay.
Totally cool. A video game. Yeah.
And plenty of people. Like, I have a lot of my friends years ago, their kids, they do that thing where they play the video game, the kid wants to play, and they hand him an unplugged controller.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Kids soak up all this stuff. By the time that they're old enough or perceived to be old enough to be handed a controller, it's not so much learning that the controller affects the character on the screen and how a game works as it is learning that specific game.
Yeah, right.
Your son, he's going to jump in and play an RPG someday, and he's not going to need to learn the basics of what it means to play an RPG because he's watched us play.
He's watched us play, yeah.
He knows what we're doing.
Tabletop RPG is what we're talking about. Yeah.
He knows what we're doing. He just doesn't know the rule set yet.
Yeah.
So
he knows we sit around the table and tell stories.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And you're making me rethink the unplugged controller that I give him whenever I play video games. Actually, the other day I put him in No Man's Sky on a world that had no harmful creatures, no bad weather, and it was basically just peaceful. And I let him just walk around.
One of my favorite stories from Skyrim was this guy who is protective of his daughter.
Mm-hmm.
She wanted to play Skyrim, so she handed her the controller. When he came back in, she had basically gone and gathered all this clothing, walked over to a river, thrown it in, picked all of it back up, walked over to the beach, and thrown it back all out. And when he was like, what are you doing? She says, oh, I'm doing laundry.
Right.
That's cute.
Just here you go.
Yeah.
That's adorable.
Very just nice. give the controller to your kids.
Love it.
Let them play it. Let them fail the game. They're going to. Constantly.
They'll mess up my save, Will.
We have multiple saves now.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. And you shouldn't care about that. You grew up, you did the same thing I did. We played games without saving.
That's right. That's exactly right. But, yeah, I honestly, I agree. I think as soon as they can hold the controller and have the fine motor skills, you know, throw them in front of it. Just, you know, watch the content, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you don't want to put them in front of something that's going to be blood and death and sex and that sort of thing.
Now,
GTA kids.
What game would I start
a
kid on? If I was going to pick one game to start a kid on, it would be Sonic 2.
There you go.
Yeah. The controller is sturdy enough that when they throw it, big deal. It's old equipment, whatever.
The original.
You mean actually on the Sega Genesis?
Well, yeah.
Okay. That's an important distinction because you can pick that game up on a whole bunch of systems now. So
The system would not matter, but on that game, it's simple enough, it's easy to play, and if they just want to hold down the right button, they're good.
Not an infinite runner, but infinitely running. Running until nothing is left but the speed.
So it's a finite runner.
Okay, and then quick lightning round. Someone just got a new console. We're going to go with PS4, Wii U, and 3DS because none of us have Xboxes that I'm aware of. Nope. So if someone just got a PS4, what game are you getting them?
Project Diva X. It's fun with groups of people. The music is phenomenal. The animation is great. And it's... Okay, I'm just a big Project Diva fan, okay?
Fair enough.
Assuming that they're a gamer, but for some reason they haven't played this, I would go with Assassin's Creed 4. I think that was the pinnacle and the peak of the Assassin's Creed series. You play as a pirate, and it's Black Flag, and it's a lot of fun.
Very cool. Jim, any thoughts on that?
It sort of depends on what sort of games they enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
I'd probably say Metal Gear Solid 5, mm-hmm. just because I love that game. I think the gameplay is fantastic, and I think it's worth playing for just about any sort of gamer.
Yeah, good trade-in value for that.
But if I was going to recommend a game for someone, you know, like, that doesn't really play, I'll say games that require a lot of hand-eye coordination that is more into, you know, story elements, I might say something like Until Dawn, which is a, you know, horror game, story-driven. It's not at all a hand-eye coordination game, so it's very much kind of an adventure-type game. It's horror, but it's like an adventure-type mystery game, which is interesting. It also looks very pretty. One of the prettiest games on the system has some fantastic facial motion capture work. So it kind of depends on the audience, but those would be kind of my two go-tos.
Mm-hmm. How about the Wii U? I know for me, I would say if the Wii U doesn't come necessarily with Nintendo Land, I know they used to. I'm not sure if they
really,
still
do. Really? Nintendo Land? You go for that?
I would say so, because it's kind of like the Wii Sports equivalent for the Wii U.
See, I'd say Mario Maker, honestly, because I think it uses the touchscreen very well.
That's a really
so
good choice.
You're getting exactly what the system can do, and it's really fun to build levels, and it appeals to people that like to play Mario games, and also those who just prefer to build games and build levels. Mm-hmm. So it kind of scratches both itches.
Yeah. I think I would recommend Nintendo Land just because it's a good party game for one, and also because it also demonstrates, and you know, I'm not saying the Super Mario Maker doesn't demonstrate the capabilities of the Wii U, but...
No, I think it does much better than Nintendo Land, because you're actually, the whole thing is about building levels and drawing things out. Mm-hmm.
But Nintendo Land has, like, you know, more of the motion things, it has more of the asynchronous gameplay. It does, these are a lot of ideas that people started to move away from on the Wii U, because they just found that, you know, maybe it wasn't practical for their game most of the time. But it really kind of, I think, highlighted the hardware in a way that no other games that came after have, except maybe, like, Wii Party U, but that wasn't, I think, as good as Nintendo Land was. So.
What are those characters called that they have with the big heads and the wooden
bobble heads?
Are you thinking Miis?
Yes, the Miis that they use on Nintendo Land. I think those are ugly.
Mean,
that's a big thing for me. I just think they're ugly.
I'm just waiting for the conversion over to completely realistic looking Westworld type you know, flesh avatars, and they just use like just a 1-to-1 representation for the Miis, and so you turn it on one day and suddenly you're looking back at yourself. It's like, oh geez, that's so creepy.
We call it the mirror.
Yeah, there you go. We just call them meat.
It's time for Game Show, where the Backward Compatible crew play a game show kind of game on their gaming show. What sort of crazy game show challenges in store this week on Game Show? Let's find out right now on Game Show.
All right, so we got a brand new game show for you guys this holiday season. We're calling it Naughty or Nice. And we have Santa Jim over here.
Ho, ho, ho.
Who is going to be deciding whether different game developers should be on the naughty list or the nice list this year.
I'm not deciding anything. Y'all are going to decide, and you just have to convince me.
Well, you see, that's kind of my point, is that we're going to have Team Naughty. That's going to be represented by Doc and Will here. And we're going to have Team Nice. That's going to be me and Sarah. We're basically going to be arguing for why we think that developer X should be on the nice list, and the others are going to be arguing for why they should be on the naughty list.
Chris, I'm going to throw a monkey wrench in your Team Naughty, Team Nice. And actually, just to be fair, we're going to have one round where y'all are Team Nice, you and Sarah are Team Nice, Doc and Will are going to be Team Naughty, but then we're going to swap it for the second round, just so that it's a little bit fair, so everybody has a chance to be naughty and nice, if that works for you.
Sure.
Okay. Oh, dear.
I think it's a little more fun to kind of see, if you know what I'm saying, just so that you don't get too comfortable being too nice.
And I think, though, this is something that only Santa Jim can decide.
Okay.
And that is, what is the consequence for someone who ends up on the naughty list?
What is the consequence? Oh, that's interesting.
Like so kids get a lump of coal.
Okay. You know,
glare at them because that's how the internet works?
we shout, we type in all caps at them.
Yes, we type in all caps.
They are banned. They are banned from any and all game-related activities. That means, because these are going to be game designers in some sense of someone involved in the gaming space. They are banned from interacting with the gaming community. They're banned from making a game or contributing to a game that is being made. They're essentially in exile.
Wow. Is this what we're basically doing to M. Night Shyamalan when it comes to Avatar?
We should be. But actually, we're going to start. We're going to go ahead and lead us off here. And we're going to lead off with Sean Murray, the developer of... actually, he works for Hello Games, owner of Hello Games, and also developer of No Man's Sky, a very divisive game that came out this year. We've got Team Nice over here, Chris and Sarah. Team Naughty, Doc and Will. Let's see. Let's go ahead and...
You're making me argue against No Man's Sky?
I'm making you argue...
Good, because that piece of trash should never have been released.
And actually, I take that back. Remember, you're not arguing against the game. You're arguing against the developer.
Oh, whether or not he was naughty.
Yes. Was he naughty? Like, not the game itself. Was he
That's
naughty?
That's what I mean.
Oh, wow.
So, or was he nice?
Who are we starting with?
Well, that's what I was. I think it makes sense.
I think generally,
like a courtroom, you start with
the prosecution.
Yeah. So we start with naughty, then we go to nice, but then we have closing statements from both.
Oh, Sean, you've been so naughty. The promises you made, Sean. The promises.
So you realize it's not about the promises. You realize that he's essentially a video game version of David Koresh.
Oh.
He created a farm and brought people in on these promises of being able to do everything and to reach out and eventually even be gathered up in a ship and taken off.
Yes.
He gave all of this to people and delivered on none of it when he got the payout.
So true.
So true. The thing is, he realized he had followers, and that power rushed to his head, which is a fully human thing to do.
You know, the unforgivable sin is that had what you described been completely accurate, the metaphor would hold that they had all been in this encampment together. Mm-hmm. But the reality is, at no point were any two people ever in the same room at the same time. They merely saw scribbles that they had been there before. And so they saw evidence of one another. And that's the greatest lie that was told, Santa Jim. The greatest one of all is that it's not a massive multiplayer online role-playing game environment in which you can play simultaneously. It is a glorified version of Spore.
Mm.
And we hated that game the first time it came out. So, are there some good things in the game itself, No Man's Sky? Well, certainly. Certainly. But it's more aptly titled No Man's Hype.
Or Every Man's Hype?
One Man Hype. One Man's Hype. There we go. I like it.
I thought I had another one when it first came out, and I can't remember what it was, but...
One Man's Hype?
Yeah. Google Image Search. Game.
What?
Oh!
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah. If you type in Spacescapes into Google and hit the image search, you basically get No Man's Sky.
It's so true. Ooh, it's so true. Well, I also think that it's a really great album cover generator for 70s rock. Yeah. But, you know, we weren't promised that that's what it would be. And so I think that's a great failing as well.
Yeah. All right. Well, what I'll do here to keep this a little bit more structured, and I gave y'all some leeway because I didn't tell you I was going to do this beforehand.
Oh, okay.
But we'll try to do about approximately 2 minutes.
Okay.
So do we still have time left?
Not really.
We took our 2 minutes.
Yeah,
and that's all we needed.
But it's gonna come back around. You're gonna have a closing statement.
We get a rebuttal.
You're not done. You're not done.
Closing statement. We're gonna do this better than the presidential debates. Got it.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Yes. These are actually gonna be structured. I will not give anyone questions.
Are you gonna cut off our mics if we start over-talking?
I will not cut off the mic. No.
Oh, okay. So exactly like the presidential debates.
The editor thanks you for not cutting off the mic.
Okay.
Last word.
2 minutes.
Okay.
All right, Chris and Sarah.
Our client dared to dream. That is the only crime he has committed. No, he had a grand vision for a game that was going to change the way we think about gaming. And yes, he made a lot of big promises, but we're not going to get... And some of the promises weren't delivered upon, I will admit to that. But we don't get anywhere in life... humanity doesn't go anywhere if we just stick to what we know we can do. You come up with something that is way out there, you say, I'm going to cross this ocean, I'm going to go to the moon, and you try and fail many, many times before you succeed, but you have to make that effort. And we've learned things from No Man's Sky. I think that this man should be commended for having dared to dream and actually going through with a project and releasing it, and then when people reacted poorly to it, hanging in there and deciding to actually go ahead and release an update, despite the fact that there's a pretty good chance that a lot of people had already given up on it.
Well, yeah, arguably, the question then at that point becomes, are we going to punish people for failing when they try to do something that's out of the ordinary?
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't mean go out and buy the game, but... How badly are you going to harass somebody? Are you going to give them another chance?
Exactly. I believe that our client deserves another chance.
Yeah. Isn't that not what we're all looking for in life?
And so does M. Night Shyamalan. He deserves one more chance.
No. Avatar He's 2. Had too many. No. No, there's a difference between one more chance and, like, one dozen more. Sorry. No. Sorry.
All right. So back to Team Naughty.
For our closing statement.
You have a closing statement. Okay. Y'all can take turns, do it however you want, but you have a minute. You do not have to take the whole time, by the way.
Okay.
Whenever you're done, just let me know.
Well, I think that the defense brought up a very important point, and that was the damning silence that occurred between the release of what was obviously an inferior product and the so-called update, which was really just shoehorning in a bunch of content that they had not bothered to release originally. So this, I think, convicts our naughty person louder than anything else.
From a marketing perspective, even if he's completely insincere, the smart thing would have been to say, updates are coming. This is not the finished product because we had to rush it. We are going to deliver. And you hold on to that until people forget about you.
That's right.
That would have been the smart thing and would have matched his character.
Very, very, very true. I think we're done.
Okay. All right, defense, closing statement.
Our client did the smart thing. He actually said at release that this is the beginning of something that will be much grander, much bigger in time.
So in other words, he already did make those statements.
Mm-hmm. And the silence afterward, I believe, is just sometimes when something happens, you need to take a moment to reflect and to drown out some of the noise. Or in this case, they even said that they were listening to feedback. Just because they didn't... I think if they came out and said something, you know, people would have found a way to take anything they said and spin it into something negative. And so the silence was just them focusing and making sure they could get to that next stage in their development and release this update that is the first step along the path to redemption.
You good?
Mm-hmm.
Ending? Okay. All right. Oh, this is interesting. Okay, this is going to be a little closer than I expected when I first handed it out.
Oh, really? Are you saying you were a biased judge, Santa Jim?
No, I just, when I handed out the assignments of who was naughty, I mean, I am biased to an extent, but I will say I'm trying to avoid any sort of bias. But I will say when I handed out the naughty and the nice assignments, I expected it to go a certain way. So it was a little closer than I expected, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. I will have to rule on the side of naughty. I think the arguments presented were just better.
I feel dirty.
I might be the only person here who hasn't played it, so...
I technically didn't play it, if you consider the 7 hours I put into it.
That's true.
I will say I didn't try to play it. I could almost feel...
But that's mostly because I listened to you guys.
You didn't play it as a...
I could almost feel Will's just the vitriol, this, like, spitting anger.
It is a very pretty 3D version of a bad Starbound.
Mm-hmm. I think that kind of put me over the top, I'll say.
Well, I put way too many hours into it to complain about the money I spent on it. But yeah, I continue to be mildly disappointed. Not outraged, just mildly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so he is naughty and he's done for next year, apparently. He's been locked away.
Oh, man.
Naughty.
Hole for Sean. Sorry, Sean.
Okay, let's go ahead and do our next designer here. And we're now switching. We have Team Naughty, Chris and Sarah, Team Nice, Doc and Will.
Yeah, because I want to feel good about myself again.
I want to feel good about you. Okay.
Well, that's going to be interesting because it's probably going
to
be Kojima.
It is actually going to be.
Yes!
Hideo Kojima.
I feel dirty again. I haven't even started.
And we're starting with Naughty. Naughty always goes first.
In the interest of full disclosure, because I have a feeling that in the previous iteration, the previous version of this game, there was a pre-existing stance by the judge. So... just in the interest of transparency, which is a huge issue currently.
Yeah.
Starting off with, do you have a strong stance on this, or even like a weak stance? Any kind of leaning at all?
Do you need to excuse yourself as counsel?
I am a long time fan of Kojima, but I've also been pretty critical of some of the choices that he's made.
Okay.
But I'm admittedly a fan of his, and have been pretty much since the 80s.
Okay.
Okay, so Team Naughty. You have 2 minutes to present your argument.
Okay. Kojima is an enigma. And one who has had his day, but has recently been rather disappointing. He has not been able to take what he's been given and make a good product. MGS5 was celebrated in a lot of ways, but in a lot of ways he could argue that it was one of the weakest Metal Gear Solids.
Oh, you've already lost.
The story...
was not where the other ones had been. While the gameplay had a great boost, it just didn't have that same kind of feel as the other games in the series. But it wasn't Kojima. It was Metal Gear game. It was a good Metal Gear game, but it wasn't Kojima. And then when he parted ways with Konami and went to go make his own studio, all we've gotten so far are very odd and very vague sort of teaser trailers for a game that might be overfunded and might end up being rather disappointing by the time it comes out.
I don't... What's a snake?
What's a snake?
I'd rather play something else. That's not
See,
helpful.
There you go. See, my counterpart here doesn't even know who Kojima is. He is someone who is well known among the gaming community. He's a has-been. He's no longer relevant. And we rest our case.
You rest your case? Really? Already? All right, well, I'm going to ignore the fact that you said rest your
the
case, and I'm assuming you do
being
return.
Being forced to argue against someone that you do not believe is naughty.
Okay, so let's move over to the Team Nice.
So, culturally, Kojima comes from a very, very harsh work environment, and I'm not talking about the work placed on him. I'm talking about the way culture works where he's from, in that work is the thing. Like, you push for it, people are broken while they're working, so when we talk about Kojima, like, being harsh on his employees... That's the whole culture. It happens to everyone. And then you take this political blowback that has pushed him out of that and kind of vilified him when that's everyone. And he's shifted to a new development studio, which takes a lot of time to do. A lot of people who do that, the Probe Game Company, took a while before they released a new game. This kind of thing happens all the time. Kojima's games... are not so much about the science fiction and the intricate storytelling of the Metal Gear games. It's about new experiments with stuff. Metal Gear 1 was your standard kind of NES game. Metal Gear 2 changed some things. Metal Gear Solid was a newer form of stuff that had been kind of done before, but not really to that extent. Metal Gear 5 is the same way. The point is not, yeah, it's a Metal Gear game, it's complicated. It's, what new features can I take advantage of? Case in point, Metal Gear 4. Adding in mic stuff, playable trailer, which I don't really like as a game, was intriguing in the fact that it used everything you could get from the PS4, if at all possible. That was the point.
It has come to my attention that former Konami president Shinji Hirano has become the president at Kojima's studio, Kojima Productions. Now, what greater testimony do you need of the brilliance of the artist we know as Kojima than the so-called villain of the studio that he worked for before coming on to work for him? Our game's art? Might as well ask that question.
Okay. Back to the prosecution. Naughty.
The fact of the matter is that when you're developing games, there's a certain expectation for quality, there's a certain expectation to deliver upon promises. We just had this discussion with No Man's Sky. Some of the best studios out there, some of the best games out there, will acknowledge when they need more time and they need more budget, and they'll get that, and they'll go in and make the game they need to make. With Metal Gear Solid 5, we had a case where they released early, and it was incomplete, and it was not up to the standards the Metal Gear Solid fans have come to expect in terms of storytelling and in terms of a feeling of completeness and of true polish. And so I would say that Kojima has kind of let everyone down. He left on a sour note, and I don't think that people don't have currently any reason to be hopeful for the future.
What you call sour, I call authentic. I mean, when you're talking about artists, true artists, and I will answer my own question. Games are art, undoubtedly. Games are art. What you have is the personality of the great artists that come through. So whenever we look at something like, Five, right, we can say, yes, here and there it had these weaknesses and these strengths, but the fact that we compare it at all, that we notice it at all as a major AAA title, indicates that it is worthy of the examination. We know almost nothing about Death Stranding, yet it is the buzz. For someone to have resurrected his career within the context of such a major scandal that was unjustly brought upon him, I think, shows the brilliance of the man as an artist.
Okay.
Con artist?
You're speaking out of
penalty,
turn,
penalty, penalty. This objection, is not football. No,
5 minutes of the penalty.
I want that stricken from the record.
For high sticking up for your side of the argument.
What's a snake?
I have to say... Actually, I'm going to have to rule with Team Nice on this one. Mainly it's because...
What?
Wait, that's us.
Dang it! That's you. That's you, Doc.
Now I feel really dirty.
I felt that the argument from Will was very strong. I liked that Doc pulled up some actual evidence, pulled up some real hard evidence and presented it.
Yeah, passion, man.
I felt that Chris really wasn't that passionate in his speech, to be honest. Sorry, Chris.
Duty calls sometimes.
So it's all about...
and Sarah didn't know who Snake was.
It's all about presentation.
And Sarah didn't know who Snake was. So. Yeah.
No one really knows who Snake is.
No
one because there are too many of them.
There we go. That is true.
There's snakes everywhere. They're under the floorboards.
So what I actually wanted to do next is instead of doing just one designer or one developer, I wanted to do kind of a general studio or general policy.
Mm.
So this next one that we're going to do... I don't know, how familiar are y'all with sort of the feedback that has been going on with Grand Theft Auto V ever since it came out? Lack of single-player content.
Kind of, sort of.
Consistent, consistent multiplayer updates, tons of DLC, shark cards, mm-hmm. You know, the money aspect related to shark cards, the concept of, hey, when is Rockstar going to actually deliver new content, single-player content? The answer is never. Plus the announcement of Red Dead Redemption 2. I'm giving you all a little bit of background here. Mm-hmm. Red Dead Redemption 2, a lot of people are excited about it. But then there's also that question of, are they going to do the same thing with Resident Evil 2? Is it going to be some sort of like online always type experience? Are they going to have like, you know, Western bucks or something that you have to buy to get mm-hmm. DLC, kind of like they do with GTA 5? So we're going to just condemn the entire studio or those behind the entire studio based on these recent developments, essentially. Alrighty, so Team Naughty. You go.
Okay. So to say nothing of the actual content itself, we'll assume... I'm going to assume that the content of Grand Theft Auto is not an issue. What I'm concerned about is the decisions they have made in their expansion model for Grand Theft Auto V. And what they have done, you'll recall with Grand Theft Auto 4, you know, the most recent game in the series besides 5, they had 3 separate DLC packs that expanded the story, that even gave you different playable characters, and really expanded the game nicely. Grand Theft Auto 5 is purely online expansions. And I think that this is especially inexcusable because if you find that you're not into the online space, perhaps you don't find the other players to be... people you want to play with, or perhaps you don't have the sort of internet connection that enables you to play online all the time like that. You are depriving single player, the avid or the loyal followers of your series who've been single player fans, of a lot of this really good content that really doesn't need to be online. There's actually a lot of really cool ideas and content that could be great single player experiences that you are restricting only to online audiences. And I think an online audience that is comparatively rather small compared to the user base of the single player purchasers of this game.
I was going to say something like, you know, the only people who really want to force people to be online all the time are trying to monitor everything they do.
Okay.
So
that's
there's that.
All right, Team Nice.
We'll get it.
All right. So here's the thing. When you're talking about this online expansion, it's Grand Theft Auto is kind of an art and an ongoing piece of experience. When you think of Grand Theft Auto, you think of the funny videos people post. Those all still exist. The majority of people who keep playing these games after they've been released are in it for what else can I do with it? I finished the game. What kind of silly things can I do if it's on the PC? How can I mod it? The first time I ran into a Rockstar game, it was Grand Theft Auto 2, and that's all people did was fool around. So saying that they shouldn't do online-only DLC is very restrictive because the fault on that is with the player. If you don't like DLC, don't buy it. If you don't like it being always online, you shouldn't get an always online game. You've still got the previous iterations. You've got all these people coming out with brand new kinds of open world experiences. Even Zelda's getting into that now. Hitting one company for doing online only DLC when all of them are doing it now, that's kind of harsh, and you're really cramping their style as badly as anyone who says they shouldn't have the content they have in those games because it's an art. Would you?
Yeah, you know, whenever you even define DLC, you've got to look into, oh, is it just cosmetic stuff or is it new adventures? What is it? And people complain. All the time you hear complaints about DLC being done wrong. Here we have an example of a company that is doing nothing wrong. And so how can we accuse them of something that they literally are not doing? It makes no sense at all. What is it that they are doing? Well, they're spending developer time on new content and new games, like, for example, Red Dead Redemption 2. This is an announcement that took the world by storm. It's amazing. It's wonderful. Now, I could not help but notice that the other side chose to completely gloss over the naughtiness element of the content itself. And that's because they fully realize that this is Rockstar. And for them, naughty is nice.
Wow.
That was pretty good. That was good. Right in the time. Okay.
I should have been a lawyer.
All right, closing arguments. Y'all are going to have to be on the ball.
For the same reason that true gamers complain about microtransactions in mobile games or even in some more modern DLC types of situations, we're giving Rockstar a pass because of their storied history. The problem is that they are not the same Rockstar we used to know. They used to release playable expansions in their single-player games, and they also had a lot of really good online content. I'm not discounting the value of online, but they are moving away from what they are good at and treading into territory that, like, yes, they can be experimental, they can be a little bit ambitious, but the fact of the matter is that it's not working the way that they thought that it might have. And we have this sort of microtransaction model that is, you know, forcing people to play by their rules and to engage in an online community they might not want to engage in. And the fact of the matter is that a lot of people choose not to. And I think that as a result, Rockstar is missing out on, you know, even just from a business perspective, a lot of people who would pay good money to buy the single player versions of these expansions in this DLC.
Okay.
Rockstar released a game that was fun to play, was fully finished, and people enjoyed. It is the players who are complaining that the extension that Rockstar added to build out their online component that they are testing and experimenting with is not enough. It is the player's fault that they don't like the new stuff that Rockstar is trying to do, even though they already got the full package.
Yeah. I mean, I gave it a try, and my experience with it was not that we were all going to team up and go do a heist together, but that I was going to get shot repeatedly by a bunch of people on a drive-by, to the point where I couldn't even pick up a first weapon. So, you know, to me, I blame the players. I really do.
Do we have one other one that y'all can think of?
The immediate problem is most of the stuff that I actually follow and pay attention to, there's people arguing that it was not blown out of proportion or that it was blown out of proportion, and then that detracts from the actual thing, which usually winds up being sexism and people who permit it and encourage it blowing it off.
Mm.
In which case, my argument is it is a very big deal. But the Foglios abstained from the Hugo Awards.
A pair, it's a couple, right?
It's a couple.
They have
a colorist that works with them.
Okay. They won 3 years in a row, the graphic novel category or for the Hugos. Then they decided to go ahead and abstain the next year. They didn't want to be part of it because they want to give someone else a chance. Is that basically what
that
the issue
is? That is the basic gist of it, yeah.
So we're going to start with Naughty. This will actually condemn them, by the way.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So here's the thing. It is an award ceremony. If your comic is not good enough to be known well enough to get nominated and awarded, then maybe you shouldn't win the award. If your comic is good enough to keep winning the award, then you should take the time to win it. You can have a wall of awards, a wall of people who've done well. Like, there's at my school, there was a wall of all these people who went on to great things. I can devalue the whole thing by putting a picture of a vagabond right next to it. As soon as you do that, everything goes down. It is your duty, your noblesse oblige, to stay in the running.
Bless you.
And win it every year if you have to, because it raises the value of all the other comics.
Well, not only that, but there is an arrogance to stepping away based on this idea of obviously we are going to win again. Mm-hmm. And so by stepping away, we're going to give someone else an opportunity to win, not an opportunity to beat us, because therein the real victory lies. But instead, it's a we know we would have won, but we're choosing not to compete because we, the great decider of these things, have already made the decision to let someone else win. And in that point, I think they should be, I don't know, invalidated from being able to ever compete again.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you're in that space of competition and you never give someone a chance to beat you, then how meaningful is the victory?
They're no longer in that position where they could win every year. I can think of three comics that could easily beat them and would have if they were still in the running at the point that these comics hit their stride.
Right. So, you know, let's strip them of their titles. Let's take away the other 3 years.
Yeah.
All right.
Wow. They're pretty good at this.
They are.
You're up. Nice.
Well, no, I would argue actually against those points specifically. The first year, they did not abstain. They were just thrilled they'd won it. The second year, they did not abstain. They were thrilled they'd won it. The third year, they looked around and realized that the award committee was not actually paying attention to the other people who were out there, some of whom could have easily beaten them. And they said, okay, you guys need to stop looking at us and start looking at all the other amazing things that are happening out here. The fact that they had to do that, I would say, does not put them on the naughty list. It puts the award committee on the naughty list. They should have known that already. They should have been paying a little more attention. So, I think it would be easy for them to just stay in the running and, you know, whether they win, you know, if they don't win, well, you know, we already had three. Or if they do win, just say, we are the best forever. But they chose to purposely shift the focus of the award committee and thereby any members of the public who are actually paying attention to the awards to the fact that there's other really great stuff out there.
What it says to me is that the Hugo Awards are very narrow-sighted, and what they're looking for is a very specific thing, and Girl Genius is the thing to them that does everything they want to do in sort of a, I don't want to say a political sense, but it's kind of like we're saying that this is the thing that is Hugo-worthy, and to not give any other award those honors for 3 years straight in a new category kind of ill-defines what the category is meant to be. And so I think that this is a good move for them to step down and to remove themselves from the running so we can see what will this award be minus this thing that has been the sole winner of the award for the past 3 years.
All right, closing statement from Team Naughty.
The purpose of an award ceremony, the purpose is evolution. Evolution of the medium, evolution of the narrative, even evolution of the creators. When you remove the need to be noticed and to break in and prove yourself for what you are, you limit that evolution, and you prevent it from allowing us to get great pieces. Schlock Mercenary put a lot of work into being what it was and was nominated for Hugo's outside of the graphic novel category, and then later into it as well. All of these things are because they evolved and they created and they were pressured. You remove that pressure, you remove the ability.
To blame the judge is probably the lowest form of winning, or in this case, losing. Obviously, they've been naughty, but we can't blame Santa for that. We have to blame...
Objection! Buttering up the judge.
All right. Out of time.
As to the point of allowing other people to prove themselves in the field, the categories for science fiction within the Hugos are, if I'm not mistaken, broad. Just saying graphic novels is not. The graphic novel Girl Genius, which is the one that won 3 years in a row, is a steampunk comedy adventure. It is very different from something like, say, Saga, which is Midsummer Night's Dream meets Star Wars, and is R-rated, by the way, but really, really excellent if you're cool with that.
there is no real comparison. If they were to properly look at those things and compare things, if they were just saying, there's a difference between saying this is the best graphic novel without thinking about genre, without thinking about, if you're saying you're looking for something that specific, you're missing out on a lot of other things. And they're not doing that with anything but graphic novels.
Okay. So this is an issue that I had never heard of before, which is good. So that helps me just be completely impartial. But I'm sorry, I'm still going to have to go with Team Naughty on this one.
Really?
The argument was just stronger.
Question, do you actually think that?
I thoroughly apologize.
Don't answer that question.
I have to thoroughly apologize to all those people in case they ever read it so they don't hate my work, because I love all of those comments. And I greatly respect the Foglios for actually standing down and allowing other people to get in.
I haven't read any of it, and I probably don't have a real opinion.
I'll tell you this. What actually got me...
Seriously.
Will had a very strong argument, but actually what convinced me was Doc's statement about how it came across as arrogant, that they thought they were just going to win no matter what.
Yeah.
That
kind of convinced me. I was like,
I don't know enough about it to know whether that's true or not.
But
like, if they'd done it after the first year or the second year, I would have said, you know, that could easily be arrogance. But after, like, the third year, when it becomes really obvious no one's looking at anything else, it's kind of like, just in case people, you guys want to give it to us again,
Is the panel just being lazy when it comes to investigating
other... Sure looked
other...
like it.
They don't read comics. The thing is, for the Hugo, stuff has to be nominated. So it's not even the judges. It's the people nominating. And so there weren't very many. It was already jokingly being called the Girl Genius Award because it kept going to them. Because it was one of the most well-known comics out there.
Mm.
So, yeah, it was...
What is the specific category? Just sci-fi graphic novel?
Yeah, just graphic novels. Whereas other things...
But it was specifically science fiction graphic novel, right?
Well, the Hugos only go to science fiction.
Right, okay.
So it didn't differentiate between subgenres.
Okay.
And they get it for other things.
Clearly, they need to split it.
They need to either split it or at the very least start considering the fact that... Again, I would not necessarily say one is better than the other between, you know, like Girl Genius and Saga.
And I think that
not off the top of my head without going into deep analysis. But they're both really good.
Which is why they take
it now. And
they're
both very different. It's like the people who argue Star Wars versus Star Trek, and I just want to, like, this is apples and oranges, guys.
They both have the word star in it.
Yeah, that's the only thing.
They do take it on...
They both have spaceships, okay?
They take it on a story-by-story basis now. For instance, XKCD's Time actually won a Hugo because of the way it was structured and presented.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, which is, again, though, very different from Girl Genius and very different from Saga and very different from so many other
things. It fixed the problem.
Sounds fixed to me.
Yeah. We're passionate about comics.
Yeah, we are.
I'm going to go ahead and bow out for today.
Leaving the party
early. Leaving the party early, yes. I'm going to go watch Rogue One.
Cool.
Yep, so, I hear it's really good.
Lots of spoilers.
It's just not the same since Leonard Nimoy is gone. They just can't carry it as well.
Right. I hear the sequel is supposed to be really good, though.
Yeah. They
have more Daleks in the sequel. It's great.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's been a shame. I would like to see, I'd like to see Dr. Zarkov in it again, and that's just not going to happen.
Yeah. I liked the dinosaurs.
Okay.
Well, and with that, thank you everyone for joining us for episode number 87 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, our holiday party. I'm Chris.
I'm Doc.
I'm Jim.
I'm Will.
I'm Sarah.
And we hope you guys have a happy holiday. See you next time.
We want you to write into the show, because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.